All right.
Hey, baby.
Hey, dude.
You sure are looking fine.
Why, thank you, baby.
Hi, this is Kat from the Duke and Kat Show, and I am here with
Duke
and
Larry.
Duke and Larry, right here at the historic Arizona Hotel. We are filming here in front of a very special mural.
That's right.
That we want everyone to be aware of, and with our good friends and partners, Art Fair. And so,
hey,
and
Alex,
we definitely want to thank TIG
for
allowing us to get these final shots
exclusive
here.
Exclusive interview with a superstar here.
Not to mention. So I think you should introduce our guest, Duke.
Yeah, and as I'm talking to you, I'm going to try to be as smooth as he is. So. If I say the words cancer and my name is Larry, you might know who I'm talking about. This man standing to my right is Mr. Larry Cunningham, and we are truly blessed to have him, one of the original members of the Floaters here in Tucson. I tell you, man, there's so many talented people here in Tucson. We've had the pleasure of meeting him a couple of years ago, and we have been wanting to collaborate for quite some time. So we are truly blessed that you took the time out on this crazy night here in Tucson to come and play with us. So thank you, Mr. Cunningham, for being here.
Thank you for having me, Duke. Yeah. You know, you guys are friends of mine, and anytime I can come around, I love it. So we all right. We all right.
Now, we are in Tucson, Arizona,
right,
and there's a lot of talented people here. How did you find your way from Detroit all the way to Tucson, Arizona?
Long story, and I'll try to make it short. You know, I first came to Tucson, though, with Marvin Gaye, 78. We was on the Marvin Gaye tour with LTD and Lenny Williams.
Oh, my goodness.
Way back in the day, we played the original Tucson Convention Center.
Oh, wow.
That was back in the day. Well, back to Detroit and married a lady who's a psych specialist. So she was recruited by the hospital here, University of Arizona. And so she came out to help run the psych ward, and I'm in tow.
And here you are.
Right?
So you came with the package.
Yeah, I came with the package. So, you know, the Floaters, we fly to work anyway. So she asked, do you know anything about Tucson? I said, it's a beautiful city, mountains all over the place. And she was ready to leave Michigan anyway. So when they came to recruit her, she said, do you want to move to Tucson? I said, let's go. So here we are.
Well, we are truly blessed. And that special lady's name is?
Cheryl Cunningham.
Well, we want to thank Cheryl. Cheryl, thank you so much for allowing this man to come and hang out with Duke and Kat. And like I said, I mean, you're a part of the original Floaters. How did that get started?
Well, you know, we were a local group in Detroit, idolizing the Temptations, Miracles, Four Tops. When I got out of high school, we used to skip school. In fact, stand outside the Motown studios and wait and try to meet our heroes. And I was a pretty decent dancer. So one of the teachers in school had me in one of the jazz classes. So I started doing choreography. And I looked up and met a guy named Smokey Robinson. And I started doing choreography for the Miracles. I did some choreography for the Four Tops. You know, this is my original step. At that time, I started working with a group called the Detroit Emeralds, very well-known national act, and then they went to Europe. So I moved to England for about 8 years, and I worked with some of the English groups that wanted to do choreography, reminiscent of the Motown stuff. And all during this time, I was always told, you need to put your own group together. So my younger brother, 4 years younger than me, he had started a group. And when they got old enough to where I didn't look funny with them. I just I brung them. The rest of the floaters are younger than me, so you know, we lost them to things like running the streets and girls and things like that. So we end up boiling down to the four group members, which was Ralph, Charles, Paul, and myself. And we were discovered by the first black vice president of a major record company. His name was Otis Smith, who you probably know from discovering Anita Baker, resurrected Bobby Womack and Patti LaBelle. And he signed us to ABC, and the rest is what Cap would call history.
I like that. He's a rhymer, too.
Yeah.
Well, you know, this is one of those things that I've always wanted to do it. And never could sing. Don't get me wrong. Never could sing, but I wanted to.
Right.
I had the heart and the chest for it, and I rehearsed every day, practiced every night, you know. And eventually, it came around where I could hold a note, you know. And we went into the studio, and we didn't have enough material to record our first album. A lot of people ask, you know, that Float On was like 11 minutes long. What happened? And in those days, and I'm sure your engineer over here can tell you, they just had to cut with a razor blade.
That's right. Yes.
So we didn't have enough material to finish the album. And this was something that we did on our live show. We worked a lot of clubs in Detroit. And this is the way we introduced ourselves in the middle of our show. Well, we fooled around with the bass line, and the engineer, Richard Becker, very famous engineer, he did a lot of the Motown stuff. He said, what is that? We need to try and capture that. So we went back in the studio and we just recorded the bass line, and each fella said their names and their astrology sign, which was popular back then, you know?
Oh yeah, what's your sign?
Yeah, what your sign is, baby. So we were gonna put each one of those, the people in the act, we're gonna put them in between each song on the album. Well, they decided to keep it whole, and it was only 3 minutes and 40 seconds. So they spliced it with the tape, and that made it 11 minutes long. So the first disco record.
Oh,
that's right.
Well, I mean, when we were, you know, at that age, when I was listening to these songs, if the woman was dancing that long, you danced that
long. Right.
And the longer the song, the more time you had to make your move.
That's
so I want to thank you for making that first 11-minute
dance.
Thank
you. Yes. You know, there's a lot of little Larrys around the country.
You know, between you and Barry White.
Yeah, that's right. Like, I get thanked all the time. I get thanked all the time. So it's good. It's good. It's good. It's good.
Well, I find that very interesting, of course. You know, you couldn't market an 11-minute song today.
No. Well, you couldn't do it back then, actually. You got a fine. Anything over 3 minutes and 37 seconds, I believe, you could, and you had to pay to the FCC. You paid a fine. But the record sold so many copies until the record company paid that. And now it's a normal to have 7, 8, 9, 11, 13 minutes of records. You know, Isaac Hayes came behind that with By the Time I Get to Phoenix, and they played it entirety. So, you know, we think we set a precedent for it. You know, I'm a dinosaur cat.
But a pioneer.
My man,
you know,
thank
you.
Thank you.
Guys opened doors for a lot of
groups. Yeah, a lot of acts, yeah.
And me, I'm you know, I'm a big fan of the groups. You know, I sing bass, so I've always wanted to
hear it.
Yeah, I've always wanted to do the Temptation thing.
I can
thing,
hear the
so.
Resonance in your voice.
Yeah, so maybe, you know, as we get older, we may just, you know.
Okay, we'll hook up.
Do some, yeah.
We'll
might,
hook up.
Yeah,
does he sing to you, Kat?
Well, on occasion, he has been known to sing to me, and he has a great voice.
Yeah,
he
I
really
can hear
does.
That.
I would love to hear it like a collaboration,
a
collaboration between the two of you.
I got to put that on my bucket list, me and Larry Cunningham.
That's right.
You know, singing a duet or. And he's got to show me some original moves. You know, too.
Can I see you in a white suit? That's what I want to know.
Well, I don't know. I don't have Leo. And my name is Duke. Hey, I'm ready.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, right, see? Right.
But now you've changed that all completely now. You are on a different, I should say, spiritual journey now, right?
Yeah, you know, as I mentioned to you earlier, I've always wanted to sing. My mother sang with the Alabama Mass Choir back in the 50s.
Wow.
And my dad was a good whistler and yodeler.
Oh, cool.
Wow.
In fact, that's how they met. You know, no lights out in the country. And he whistling down the road. And she said, hey, you know, who is that? So anyway, I was conceived that way.
Wow.
So at any
in point, love, in
yes,
love.
That's right. Oh, I'm a child of love. I'm a love child. Well, my mother used to instill in us great good old gospel stuff. Mahalia Jackson, some earlier Pastor Franklin, Aretha Franklin's father. We used to listen to those kind of things on 78s.
Oh.
Later on, she started buying me 45s, and I used to sing around the house a lot. And I promised my mother that after my success with the Floaters, that I would record a spiritual album in her honor.
Oh,
and we lost her to cancer. So I decided to keep my promise. And so once I got here in Tucson, kind of chilled out, you know, everything is kind of laid back here. We have the same ambiance as San Diego, you know, just we don't have the ocean.
That's what we got here.
Lots of beach, but no ocean, you know. So we decided to go in Luna Studios here in Tucson. And myself and my my pastor's son, D. Grady Scott II, we recorded, produced, wrote, and produced an album, CD. And we entitled it The Essence of Grace, which is reminiscent of the church that I belong to here. I just love the church and the people there. And we utilized the choir. We utilized the musicians. We even have my pastor doing the spoken word on there. A young lady named Dancia, who was born and raised here in Tucson, and she has a national record deal. So we have her as special guest. We also have the pastor's wife, the First Lady Teresa Scott. She's doing guest vocals with me on the CD. So we tried to involve as many people as we could from right here in Tucson.
That sounds wonderful.
Yeah, and you guys are working on a music video too, right?
Well, actually, we've recorded two videos. We did one here downtown. We recorded it to the song You're Never Alone. You'll see me as a bum until I find a cross in the garbage can. Yeah. And we finished that just a couple of days ago. We shot some shots on the railroad tracks here, and the police ran me away. $250 ticket trying to shoot a video.
Oh, yeah. We learned about that too.
Yeah, you have to have a permit, Larry.
Yes. They say they don't care about
No. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's so I give the police officer one of my CDs, and he gave it back. He said, no, I'd rather see a permit. So we finished that video. We also did one to the song called, you'll have to excuse me, I got a lot of things running around in my head. It's called So Glad to Be Here in the House of the Lord. So it's up tempo. Mm-hmm. It's one of those nice things that we like to do.
Well, we're going to play one of those videos, maybe a clip or two from that, but we're also going to play the famous Float On video, and you'll
Thank
see
you.
It, man.
Thank
He's
can't wait for our audience to see that.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, when you talk about 78s and 33s and 45s, you're going to have to explain that to the young people at the with the titles at the bottom, what that really is.
Right.
So, it must be Cheryl.
Yeah, no, that's
the Lord.
That's the Lord.
Oh, yeah.
Hello, Lord. Yes.
But we really want to thank you. That's okay. Look, this is how we roll at the Duke.
Okay, that's good.
We are always improv.
But me and you are talking Duke, and Kat is here like she's out of place. She's too young to remember this kind of
Look,
stuff.
Look, I done robbed the cradle too many times.
Ooh.
With that, you know what I'm saying? So. But
won't touch that one. Yeah.
But we really want to thank you.
Thank
one of these
you.
Days, I want to sit
you.
Down with you, and we're going to do a real in-depth interview.
Really extended interview.
And,
I have. At least and have 10 Cheryl, more questions I
yeah, and
answer.
Have Cheryl come on, and because
she's
been with you the whole road, and we truly appreciate her. Thank you, Cheryl, for letting us borrow Larry tonight. And
thank you, sweetheart.
We will be playing the video right after this. So, ladies and gentlemen, again, Mr. Larry Cunningham.
Thank you, dude.
The historic man from the Floaters.
Thank you.
And my name is Larry. Now I like a woman who loves her freedom. And I like a woman who can hold her own. And if you fit that description, baby, come with me. Take my hand. Come with me, baby, to love land. Let me show you
and my name is Charles. Now I like a woman that's quiet, a woman who carries herself like Miss Universe.
And my name is Larry. And I like a woman that loves everything and everybody. And you know what, ladies? If you feel that this is you, then this is what I want you to do.
Respected man and all, you're gonna see we don't run into any trouble. See, we're gonna ride into town nice and easy like. We're gonna find a saloon, have a couple drinks with the marshal here, let all the folks know it's we're old pals.
We two fellas know Jesse from
a few years back in Tucson.
Then we're gonna stroll right in that bank, take that tombstone payroll, and breeze right on out of town.
Marshal, don't you be trying anything funny like. Some of these fine town folk out here will catch a bullet, and you'll be the first one.
Hello, Duke and Cat Show fans. I am Cat Meow, and we are here at the Art Fair. Yes, at Arizona Hotel. We're still on the Duke and Cat Show, and we have some very interesting guests coming up next. Stephen Bowie, Brandon Lee, and Duke Stanberry, a.k.a. Dr. Kevin Rossman. Here to tell us about that is Brandon Lee. Tell us about your project, Brandon.
Awesome. Thank you, Kat. I'm Brandon Lee. I'm the project director for Fallout Project Brazil. It's a modification for New Vegas from Bethesda and Obsidian Entertainment. And our modification contains its own new story, several hours of gameplay. It has its all-new maps, and tons of voice acting, and Dr. Duke Stansberry here. Dr. Kevin Rossman, he opened up our video game for the second plot line that we have throughout the game. So it's really exciting.
And so tell us old farts here who don't know anything about this world, and I'm thankful that you brought me into this world, but what is the premise of the games? How do they interact so well?
All right, so the game is a role-playing game. It's a first-person shooter role-playing game, so the person that's playing the game is playing from a first-person perspective, is seeing straight through the character's eyes. They come up with their own new stats, with their charisma, their endurance, or luck, that kind of thing. And they use those stats to then play a certain character type as a role. And they use that role then to talk to different characters, go on quests, go on missions, get different guns and stuff, and shoot bad guys. And Dr. Rossman is the first character that they meet in the nerd plotline. They have the choice to become a nerd or an athlete
or
in the video game.
Right.
And he opens them up, he introduces the story. He then goes on to kind of be a father figure to that character and teach them all about how to play and then what the story in the background is like.
I guess it's time for me to play Dr. Rossman, Medicine Man, again. I'll try to be a little bit more pleasant this time.
Dr. Rossman. Oh, Jesus. Oh.
Aw, come on, man. I don't have time for this.
Dr. Rossman, help me up. God.
What in the hell is wrong with you?
I fell down.
I can't believe this. I was this close to working out what was wrong with Jane. And now I have to tend to some dumb kid that can't even grasp the basic concept of football.
I don't even know why I was on the team.
Brains. Needs to grow more brains. You really knocked yourself out cold, kid. Nothing a couple of stim packs can't take care of. Now sit your ass down and let me take a look at you again. Damn.
I'm sexy, right? What happened? Dr. Rossman, the robotics and computer analytics teacher?
One and the same. Surprised you recognized me through that haze of stupid you're in. What were you thinking, trying to play football with the jocks? I'm sorry to break the news, kid, but the prognosis is in. You're a chronic nerd.
It was really fun, you know, to do this. And is this your first time doing this? Or you guys collaborated on something before, or are you?
We've collaborated on short stories before, and we've just done some group writing before. But this is the first video game project we've collaborated on. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And what was your role in the whole?
I helped with the writing. I helped with the dialogue and editing and tweaking things.
All those words I said you created?
Not all of them, but I
helped. No. Yeah. And no, I mean, it really was a pretty cool, and Kat was there to... You
know. This was very interesting to me because I got to come and just observe, be kind of behind the scenes for a while, and we were there for this process. I stayed there for 5 hours while... and I just have to say, attention to detail, that's what I saw. It's incredible. And then Duke stayed there probably another 5-6 hours just to finish it up. It was really amazing.
He was born in a vault.
Okay.
Out in Tucson, Arizona. And this is 200 years after a substantial nuclear war has wiped out most of the planet.
Okay.
So there isn't much audio to hear, unfortunately.
Oh, okay.
We haven't done it yet. That's what we're doing today.
Oh, okay.
So.
All right. See, this is the kind of screen we need so we can see.
I'm telling you.
Us blind.
This is behind the scenes with Dr. Kevin Rossman, a.k.a. Duke.
From Vault 18.
Out. And over here we have the creator, director,
Mr. Brandon Lee
and his cohort.
Stunning Stephen Bowie.
All right, guys.
Stunning Stephen Bowie.
Bowie?
Yes.
But really?
Yeah.
All right, cool name. I like that.
Then when I saw the game,
It's awesome.
Oh, we're truly impressed.
I do have just one little question for you. Does Dr. Kevin Rossman have a lot of online fans?
He does, actually. Yeah, people really love Dr. Rossman. It's super cool.
We're nerds, right?
Yeah. Part of Dr. Kevin Rossman was written by an English woman named Rosalind Kelso. She wrote probably about 30, 40 of his lines.
Oh, wow.
And then out of his 500, that was the rest. It was me. And then Stephen donated quite a few at the very end when we were doing the editing. So.
And 500 lines is what we did.
Yeah.
Say it this way, don't do it that way.
I think the end count was 620 lines from you. Throughout the entire game, there's 2,700 currently.
Wow.
And there's going to be 5,000 by the end of the second installment. So,
wow.
Yeah, it was a good 10-hour day.
We had fun. We really did have fun. But
yeah.
People don't really know what goes on behind the scenes of characters or animation and who
there's a lot.
Yeah, I mean, you guys had a great crew to put that together. You know, it really looks great on YouTube. So other than YouTube, how can people actually get the game or play it?
If you do a really quick Google search for Fallout Project Brazil, you can find it that way. We have it on the New Vegas Nexus and on ModDB. So those are two main distribution websites for us.
Any projects coming up for you in the future?
Well, we're working on the second installment, getting things rolling with that.
And Dr. Great. Rossman shows up as a hologram in that one.
Ooh, I can't wait to see that.
There's a bit of a spoiler for the first installment. Dr. Rossman dies at the end?
No!
Yeah, Coach, Colonel, Colonel Bragg.
What?
It's a bit of a spoiler. So.
The best ones always die.
Yeah,
the best characters
always die.
He was a good-looking guy, so.
Yeah.
Well, you'll just have to create another character for Duke's great voice.
Well, he does. He comes back as a hologram. It turns out that in the wasteland, because this is a post-apocalyptic role-playing game, the world's gone to hell, and it's just like a complete wasteland.
Isn't that the truth?
Yeah.
Next year, right?
Next year. 2014. Fallout. But there's a vault out in the middle of the wasteland that he'd reprogrammed an old hologram emitter to portray his personality for anybody that had come across it. Specifically, he wanted to train these tribals in the wasteland nearby how to gain their own water access from the technology and use the hologram to be their personal interface, kind of like a deity.
Uh-oh.
So Dr. Rossman kind of comes like this godlike figure out to the player.
Can't get rid of him.
And
he must be a Leo.
And then that then becomes the player's Dr. Rossman contact in the second installment. So you'll be coming back for another probably like 4 hours in the future.
You hear that?
Yeah.
Thank you. But no, I'm truly thankful that you guys, you know, took the time out to come to our show. This is the historic Arizona Hotel. This is our last shoot. I mean, this is going to be turned into something else. So you guys are, yes, truly in a
part of history,
historic and artful place, right? The art fair runs the place. Thank you, Tig and Gabby and everybody here that's been so thankful. I mean, helpful. Helpful. And it's hot in here. I think that's what I'm melting here in a second. But thank you guys for allowing us to come here and play in the second story of the hotel. We got a lot of great stuff getting ready to happen to. We got the azlivetv.com on now, so we're going to show everybody in the whole state about what you guys are doing
here. That's cool.
In every little small town like Anagam and what is it? I'm finding out Tuweep. You know, there's all kind of little towns.
Jerome.
Yeah, there's all kind of towns in Arizona. So we want to broadcast to each and every one of you guys. We want to be there. We want to meet you guys. Even if there's 25 people in your town, we're coming. All right, we're coming.
That's cool.
And we want to let everybody know that, hey, and you might find some more characters in these little towns.
When you do the Sedona tour, I want to come with you.
Oh, you know we're going to Sedona, that's for sure.
I had just one final question I just have to ask, you know, you guys. And that is because I saw that this is like a very intense kind of, you know, activity that you're doing. It's very focused for long periods of time. And I want to know, what do you do to relax? What do you do to let that pressure off? Do you play video games?
Yeah, actually, as soon as Project Brazil came out, I hopped on and downloaded it and played it through 3 times just to be able to live in the world that was created in front of me. It was amazing.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
I want to, you know,
I really want to get it and play against myself or, you know, as a
character. And what about you, Brandon? How do you decompress?
I don't ever decompress. I just use it to focus more work.
I love it.
Because I work. I'm doing a job for a video game company also. So I've got that. Then I'm doing post-production on a feature film. And then I'm doing little bits and pieces of the second installment of Project Brazil. And I'm doing the preliminary work on something called Shadow Star, which is going to be my next big space-based RPG.
Well, exciting times for you both.
Hopefully it'll start paying me better.
Well, yeah, you know, exactly. That's what we're all working on.
But you know what they say, do what you love and the money will come.
Hope so.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. Well, again, thank you guys for showing up. We truly appreciate it. And again, how can people find Project Brazil?
The best way to do it is just do a Google search. The more Google searches we get, the more hits we get. And then vote for us on Mod of the Year 2013 on ModDB.
You heard it here. DukeandCat.com, AZ Live TV. Thank you all.
Daniel's such a loser. He's so weak and defenseless. It's like shooting fish in a barrel.
Sup, sweetness?
Such an asshole. Now I know why his dad beats on
him. I'm gonna beat you with this bottle. You understand me?
Can you believe it?
I said I'm fine.
No one sees anything. Not one goddamn witness.
I really should clean this shit up.
Let's take him for a swim.
What was your problem?
Whoever it is picking on you, whoever's making you feel small and unsafe, you should fight them.
What? Wanna get in trouble?
No!
Chad, you're the pussy! Come over here and let's finish this!
Hotel. This is a building that was built in 1916 here, right off of 6th Avenue, and right now it is across from the Ronstadt bus station, transit station I should say, but it has just been bought by a out-of-town, out-of-state, out-of-country, I believe, company, and it won't be the hotel anymore. So we are truly thankful to T. Collins and Gabby to allow us to come here and shoot one of our rare shows right here at the Arizona Hotel.
Howdy, folks. I'm Texas singer-songwriter Billy Wilson, and I'm here to promote my new release. The title is I'm On the Phone Again. It's we got an upcoming cassette and 8-track release party. A couple of tracks on here. Like I said, the title of the new release is I'm On the Phone Again, and all the songs are about communication and being on the phone and stuff like that. We got one cover on there. It's Yakety Yak, Don't Talk Back. There's a couple of songs inspired by my ex-wife, Balderdash, Ballyhoo, and Brouhaha, and Shut Your Frickin' Pie Hole. I'm going to sing my hit song right now. It's called Obama Phone. It's a hit because I posted it on YouTube, and we got one hit now. So here it is. My Obama phone. I just can't wait to get my Obama phone. I'm jobless, homeless, I ain't paid my student loan, but I can't wait to get my Obama phone. Oh, what a score. Text and pictures that I couldn't send before. Them extra minutes I'm signing up for more. Internal revenues and knocking at my door. It's a field day, mining data from the information highway. So talk all day, just be mindful every single day of what you say on your Obama phone. I just can't wait to get my Obama phone. Them wackos say the man's a King Tut human clone, but I can't wait to get my Obama phone. Yeehaw! Come what may, lifting data off the information highway. Rush Limbaugh say, tain't nothing but a stinking liberal giveaway. Cause we don't pay for our Obama phone. I just can't wait to get my Obama phone. My social service worker gives me methadone and says I qualify for my Obama phone. Thank you, folks.
Walking down the street and I found Marilyn Monroe, and we thought we'd bring her up here and introduce her, right?
Yes, and she's a dead ringer.
I'm telling you,
for,
look at this.
For Marilyn, yes. But we are really blessed and proud to introduce to our Duke and Cacho audience our lovely and talented production assistant, Miss Diane Dubay. She's also a filmmaker. Very accomplished, and a little bit later on we'll be able to see maybe a clip from one of her films. But thank you so much for coming on, and Diane, and she helps us with so many things, doesn't she?
I think we would call her the Jill of all trades. So,
well, thank you, go ahead and introduce
yourself to everybody.
Yes, and my name, as you just heard, is Diane Dubay, and I am a filmmaker, photographer, model, and actress. And I am getting my bachelor's degree right now in film at the Art Institute here in Tucson. And I'm going to begin my senior year at the end of the month.
I knew you were young.
Congratulations.
I knew she was young.
She's
I
a senior. Which, not that kind.
Which means that it's senior film time. So it's like your final thesis. On top of all of your other classes.
And what lovely school are you attending?
Like I said, it's the Art Institute here in Tucson.
Nice school.
And I'm in the film program. I love that school. I love my instructors. We just like a little family there.
And I'm so happy to be asked to be on the show today.
Well, we thank you because a lot of people see how beautiful Kat looks, but they don't see who the lady that puts her together here. So we want to thank you for that too. And she makes me look good too every now and then. It's all natural.
Well, tell us a little bit about the clip that we're going to see.
Well, I wrote this piece as kind of a farewell to a love.
Aww.
It did not end well. I got a great film out of it.
Well, see, that's how it always happens, right? Great songs come from tragedy.
Because out of the passion and the heart.
You reel about it. That's
you have
right.
to pour your heart into your art, and that's what we're going to see. But I do have a production name now. It's called Dame Production.
I like it.
That's
wonderful. You can come work with us. You can always, because we need an all-girl crew for a cat show. I mean, a solid woman's crew. No guys, none of that, because I just want to see all that. And see if it can actually work. They said it couldn't be done.
It will be done.
Right.
Duke and Cat Show fans, it looks like the gauntlet has been thrown down.
I have a feeling. Pick it up and run with it.
That is right.
All these women out there, if y'all want a show done, these are the ladies to come in and hook this up. You got some American Shooters and Vail and all kinds.
We've got some great things coming up on Walk
Women
on the
Bikers
Wild Side
and all kind of stuff. We're going to be producing some stuff on AZ Live
Wait
TV,
till you
people.
See it.
It is about to crack.
Till you see it. Thank you, Diane, for everything that you have helped us with. You're also a wonderful photographer, just an all-around great
asset to the family.
We can't even really say that you're an assistant because you just helped us so much. Thanks for being on the show.
Thank you.
Thank you, Duke.
We will continue to shine because of Marilyn Monroe, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Right.
And then those other two ugly guys behind the camera. We'll bring them in front of the camera one of these days, but I gotta warn my audience first.
We have to get them some new shirts.
We're waiting for Wrinklepalooza.
The Wrinklepalooza, that's right. We're gonna be going. We love you guys, and we're gonna be right back after this.
Arizona. I am Kat, co-host of the Duke and Kat Show, and you're watching us here on azlivetv.com, where we're all Arizona, all original, all the time, and on Access Tucson, where Tucson is on TV. And we are so honored today to be here with Mayor Jonathan Rothschild. Thank you so much for coming on our show and letting our viewers get to know you a little bit. You've been on our A-list for quite some time.
I was going to say, it's my pleasure to be here. My pleasure that you came up to the office, and I know you've been trying to get me on the show, and here I am.
Yes, and we appreciate that very much. So we definitely want to, we know that you have limited time. Mayor Jonathan Rothschild is hard at work for all of the citizens of Tucson. And what inspired you to go into politics, Mayor?
Well, I've always had been interested in public affairs, but like most of us, when I was young, I never aspired to be in politics, but I always took an interest in current affairs. But like most of us, I got to the point where I got married and started to raise a family and need to make a living, and really did not involve myself in political matters. I was very involved in community affairs with some of the nonprofits. And, I'm going to say somewhere around 2004, I was looking at the world and looking at kind of the state of things and maybe drinking the tea a little of what I was reading at the time, and said, people of our generation always said we were gonna work to make changes, and I don't know that we did. So I said, I'm gonna go see what this is about. And I went down to the Democratic headquarters. I didn't even know where it was, quite frankly, at the time. And within a few weeks, they had me involved. And I, well, maybe I'll go be mayor and see if that helps. And so I just sort of set out on that mission, met as many people as I could around the community, and here I am.
Well, congratulations to you for that. And that is actually very, it's gratifying for myself as a voter to hear that there are people who are inspired still to go into politics with the goal of it being public service.
Yeah, and I think one of the things we need to do as a community, as a society, is we need to really engage our young people to do the same.
Great. Well, tell us a little bit. I think people are really, really curious. What does the mayor do every day? tell us a little bit about some of the things that you do.
What I like to do, people ask me that question a lot, and I pull mm-hmm. my iPad out and uh-huh. and I sort of go through a day, and every day is different, mm-hmm. And people are pretty blown away when I show them the variety of what we do. But so, instance, for today, if I can remember, mm-hmm. I met this morning with the water department mm-hmm. talking about how we might be able to expand some of the water conservation incentives like rainwater harvesting. After I meet with you, I'm going to be meeting with a person who's interested in building a hotel downtown. Now, mm-hmm. We see those pretty regularly, but it'd be nice to, you never know when you're going to get the person who's actually going to be able to do it.
Right.
Then this afternoon, I'm actually going out to the north side where there's a group of industry people that want to talk about a technology cluster here in Tucson.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'll speak to them. And then tonight, I'm going to be speaking with the Democrats of Oro Valley, who are not exactly voters in Tucson, mm-hmm. but again, getting the word out about what we're doing in Tucson, because everybody in this valley, I think, is in it together. In the meantime, I will likely have some conversations with city council people about just different issues that they've got coming up, and just getting a sense from them of where they want to go, and give them a little idea of where I think we ought to direct ourselves,
mm-hmm.
and just have those conversations, and it stays busy.
Yes, I imagine it does. And what time does your day start?
I start at, I'm usually here by 6 in the morning,
mm-hmm.
so 6 to 8 is when you can get the work done, and then the rest of the day goes, and I pretty much go to 8 at night,
mm-hmm.
and now at 9 o'clock I go to sleep, so.
Well, as I said, he's hard at work for all of us here. Now, we recently just had a city election. Mayor, would you care to comment on that?
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I was personally very pleased with the results. I believe the incumbents would win. I was a little surprised by their margin of victory, but I was happy with it. But the part that I was most pleased with was the propositions, because those propositions did not have lobbies, they did not have people out advocating, there wasn't money supporting them, and they were tough propositions. And what that said to me, I hope, is that people are noticing that we're doing a better job, that we're re-earning the trust of the voters, and that they can see the city as a positive in the community as opposed to a negative. And that's very important to me. That's one of the reasons I decided to do this. So it was a good night.
Tell us a little bit about really your long-term vision for the city of Tucson.
It's bringing jobs to Tucson. It is making city government efficient. It is being a part of the community and community initiatives. And finally, it's preserving our environment. For the city, it's really a question of we're in a new reality. At the city level, we don't really get to control our revenue. We have sales tax, and so the only way we can really expand our base is through annexations, which we're working on, and having a stronger business community.
Absolutely,
And those are slow processes, and our fixed expenses keep going up, so we always are having to look for ways to be more efficient. And a lot of that is going to have to do with technology. So dealing with the reentry population, people coming out of prison, dealing with the refugee population, who are people who have come here, the United States government has invited them here, but there's a lot of work to do dealing with our childhood literacy. So we've started initiatives in all those areas, ending veterans' homelessness. And, you know, I guess it's probably my passion, so I enjoy doing that work, but it's very important to strengthen the community. Mm-hmm. And finally, in the area of the environment, the city basically has the water department. So we can do a lot and have done a lot to conserve water. We have to, because without water in the desert, there's mm-hmm. not going to be a lot else here.
Exactly.
You know, but then we also try to promote, and you know, we need to do more work in Phoenix to get some incentives, but we should be a solar capital. Our clean air, our clean water, our open space are one of the reasons people want to come here.
We couldn't help but notice that there's a Get Your Business Online campaign perhaps going on. Do you want to tell us about that? We're business people, and we know that getting your business online and everything that we can do in our community to make our local entrepreneurship stronger is a very important thing.
Yeah, no, we want to, you've got, you're seeing the swag on my desk.
Yes, but, yes, we couldn't help but notice.
No, it's good. Basically, Google has come to Tucson, and they mm-hmm. want to partner with the city to help us promote a Get Your Business Online program.
Wonderful.
And we should, hopefully within the next month, go out, and you know, we need to get it all organized, but mm-hmm. go out on in a very public way and basically show people how going online can help improve their business. And you know, one of the things for Tucson, which is so great about it, is we are a very, you know, we are still a small business community, and the way the world is now, you can really locate your business anywhere. Mm-hmm. One of our great strengths is this is a great place to live, and mm-hmm. so we should be a place where people who are doing online business want to be, because they can do their business from anywhere at the same time live in a beautiful place. Mm-hmm. We also have in our community, you know, a great entrepreneurship program over at the University of Arizona, a lot of technology education at Pima and the university. And so, yeah, we're going to go out and try to help our local businesses at the same time promote our technology economy.
Well, Tucson is such a great place, and we love it here. And tell us what's one of maybe your favorite things to do. What does the mayor do to relax? Because this schedule that you're keeping,
yeah,
6 in the morning till 8 at night, he's working for us, everyone. What do you and your wife like to do to relax?
Well, we like to exercise, so mm-hmm. we'll go hike Tumamoc or get on some, you know, spinning bikes or go out and walk in the Catalinas or the Rincons. So we really like to do that. And so the exercise is really great. The other mm-hmm. thing, which I love to do and have had less time, is just read good literature, read mm-hmm. good nonfiction, just for fun. I think when you find a great author who writes well and you can get into that world, it, you know, it expands your mind, it relaxes you. So I love mm-hmm. to do those things.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Do you have a favorite author?
Well, you know, I have a lot of favorite authors. Uh-huh. I always like to say Mark Twain.
Uh-huh.
You know, every now and then I'll go back there. It's sort of a combination of mm-hmm. of humor and in a very serious social realism. So,
mm-hmm.
yeah,
no. One of the greats.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Absolutely.
Wonderful. Well, I want to mention that today Duke is behind the camera. Thank you, Duke. We do it all at azlivetv.com. Yeah. And again, we so appreciate you taking the time to talk with us and introduce yourself and all the great things that are happening at the city of Tucson, because I believe it is very important to get the word out to the public. And are you ready for my final question?
Sure.
Okay. And here it is, ladies and gentlemen. Burial or cremation?
It's a good question. So in my tradition, in my religious tradition, and for various other reasons that sort of gone over time, the answer is burial.
Mm-hmm.
And so my guess is that's what it'll be.
Okay.
Boy, I don't like thinking about that.
Well, no, probably none of us do, but we really very much appreciate you taking the time out to talk with us today and to bring your message to the world of online television.
Great.
Which is where the world is headed. So again, we are here on azlivetv.com, all Arizona, all original, all the time, and accesstucson.org. Please support local community media on TV. Mayor Jonathan Rothschild, thank you so much.
Well, thank you for having me.
All right.